times the problem, 8 times the problem, and you just have to go after it over and over again. So our next speaker is Linda Rohleder, and she's going to be touching on another one of those little controversial issues, but we felt it was very important to include it. Talking about deer and invasive species. So Dr. Rohleder received her PhD in ecology from Rutgers University, where she studied the effect of deer on forest understory diversity. She currently leads the Lower Hudson PRISM, a partnership among more than 40 organizations in the Hudson Valley that deal with invasive species. And she also runs a program of several hundred volunteers that survey and remove invasive plants. So thank you very much for being here.
And you can advance.
All right, thank you. Is this on?
Sorry, okay. I'm talking to the other one. Would you like that one?
This one I think will be easier because okay. Then I can be closer to.
There.
Okay, that's better. All right, we don't have a lot of time. We're behind schedule, but this topic I think could probably take up a whole few days worth of a conference. So my goal here today is to just skate over the issues and the connections, give you some pointers to some research, and give you some of the ideas that are being discussed out there. All right, so since we're at an IPM conference, I thought I should start with some IPM connections. And the first thing I always like to start my talks out with is, what is our goal? It's not just to remove invasives or control invasives. It's to protect something. And we always have to keep in mind what we are trying to protect. We're trying to protect a native ecosystem or community. We're trying to protect habitat for a rare species or to protect a rare species itself. And just like in many integrated pest management scenarios, you can't achieve success with just one solution, especially if there's multiple factors involved. So what are some of the other factors that are impacting our native communities or our rare species? Well, one of the biggest ones is deer. And so deer are a native species. They are native to our environments here. At normal levels, they do serve an important function in the ecosystem, and that is to browse vegetation to create diversity and heterogeneity in the environment. So it allows more species to exist and provides more different habitats at normal levels of browse. And this is related to something known as the intermediate disturbance hypothesis. So you don't want too much disturbance, you don't want too little disturbance. The intermediate amount is the right amount to keep the environment in its most biodiverse condition. So what we're looking for is a more heterogeneous environment with more levels of structure and more habitats for organisms to live in. But excessive levels of deer browse have many negative effects. So browsing by deer has dramatic effects on forests. Failure of canopy species to regenerate, that means we won't have forests in however many years it takes for those canopy species to die because there's no young individuals growing. Reduced or eliminated populations of specific species, so species that can't grow out of the browse area are going to end up getting eliminated. Increased abundances of other species. So the species that aren't browsed become more dominant. And this is particularly ferns and sedges. So if you're looking for something to recommend people that have an extremely high deer browse problem, ferns and sedges usually do not get hammered as badly. And an overall reduction in herb diversity. So because of these impacts, deer have been called keystone herbivores or even ecosystem engineers. They have, this single species has the power to affect an entire ecosystem and to have indirect effects on a lot of other taxa, including birds and insects. So here's some key examples of deer browse. On the left is a seedling sapling that has been sprouting from the root system, and it keeps getting browsed off. So you see a lot of sprouts at the bottom that keep getting cut off. And so that's one key indicator. And then on the right, you see a forest, and this is actually in New Jersey. There are many forests in New Jersey that look like this. There is no understory. There are no plants growing in the deer browse area. And you can see a line in the background there. That's as the deer have eaten everything below that line. They are not reaching above the line, so that's why there's a line. And so this is a typical example of a heavily deer damaged forest. This forest will not be there unless some management action is taken in the future. Okay, so effects on the height and diversity of many species. These are important studies because some of these species may be indicators. If you don't have a very bad deer browse problem yet, if you start seeing the decreases in the average height of these species, the oak saplings, black gum, American arborvitae that was mentioned earlier today, jack in the pulpit, Trillium species, white turtlehead, and there's a number of other ones that I didn't put on this slide. If you start seeing a decrease in the height of those species, even though they may still be there, then your deer population is starting to increase beyond the normal levels. And decreases in the numbers of species in the diversity layer. So after a time of getting heavy browse, especially the flowering plants where their flowers are getting cut off, they're not going to be reproducing much anymore, so they will tend to fade out of that understory, and so the diversity will disappear. So there's also indirect effects. I mean, aside from the direct effects of deer eating the plants, this is one I really like. You know, I really admire these guys for figuring it out. So I mentioned that the fern layer tends to increase under heavy deer browse because the deer don't eat it. This is a picture of hay-scented fern dominating the forest understory. And they decided to figure out the mechanism why there were no tree seedlings growing up in this through this fern understory. And it turns out that, yeah, the seeds of the tree seedlings were there, but the rodents were eating them, and the rodents were able to eat them more easily because the rodents were protected from predation by this fern layer. Okay, so the predators on the rodents couldn't see the rodents. So this is an example of these really indirect effects of what's going on with the deer in the forest. So there's also legacy effects. So the ferns are an example of legacy effects. So even if you got rid of all the deer in that forest, the ferns are still there. Okay, they're still preventing tree seedlings from growing because of that indirect effect. And so Alex Royo in Pennsylvania did this study where they did intensive deer management in a forest over 7 years and looked at the herbaceous layer recovery after that. And they found that although the height and the abundance of many of the species increased, the overall species diversity did not increase. And what they attributed to that to is a depauperate seed bank. The seeds of those missing species aren't in the soil anymore. They're not there. So some of the species that have disappeared under the heavy deer browse, they're not going to come back without assistance. So that's one legacy effect. And then also the dominating browse-resistant understory, the ferns and the grasses, which were taking up space and sort of not allowing establishment of other species in those areas. So these are legacy effects that even if you get rid of the deer, these are still going to cause problems unless further management is taken. Okay, so right now, up and now, I haven't talked about anything about invasives. But before we get into invasives, I want you to understand a little bit about looking at deer, okay? Because, you know, if you're going to obviously, if you're trying to protect an ecosystem, then deer are a big factor. You are going to have to consider it. So how do you figure out what the deer populations are? The common management objective is to get under about 8 deer per kilometer square or 20 deer per mile square. But this varies. Different environments, depending on how productive they are in terms of vegetation growth, can support different levels of deer. If the environment isn't that nutrient rich and it's not growing that much food and vegetation, it's going to be able to support a lot lower deer population level. So that means even at these levels, this level might be too high for that type of environment. But how do you measure this? Okay, so you can do harvest counts where you count the number of deer that have been killed by hunters and sort of get an idea of the population that way. You have to factor into account the effort that has been put in, how many hunters are out there. You can do spotlight counts. This is where you drive around at dawn and at dusk with a spotlight and you shine it and see if you get reflection off of the deer's eyes and sort of estimate the number of deer that way. You can do an infrared flyover count. Get a helicopter and take an infrared and you fly over, and of course infrared is going to glow when the bodies are hot, right? So you'll be able to see where the deer are and you can get a good count of the number of deer. You can do a deer pellet survey. The pellets are the poop of deer. So you can go out and you can count how many poop piles there are. Okay, but as I've been talking about these, you can probably think of problems with all of these. Harvest counts, that depends on the deer, the hunter effort and where they go. They're not going everywhere, they're not killing everything, and you have variable effort and variable skill. Spotlight counts, if you're driving, then you're only going near roads, so what about, you know, areas that don't have roads? Are there deer there? The infrared flyover counts are actually the most accurate, but what's the problem with that? Cost. Right, yes. So, I mean, not everyone can afford to rent a helicopter to fly over their park, right? And the deer pellet survey is actually a fairly good one too, but you miss a lot. And there's a way to make that a little more accurate. You can train dogs to sniff out the pellets, which does make it a little more accurate, but then, you know, some more effort involved in that as well. So all of these have their limitations, and that gives you an idea of how many deer per square mile you have. You get an estimate, but that really doesn't tell you about how many deer per square mile you can support. So it might actually be better to look at the deer impact and measure how much impact you're seeing, regardless of how many deer are there. If you're not seeing an impact, that's probably okay, the number of deer that you have. So the first one a lot of people do is they put up deer exclosures. Deer exclosure is basically a fence to exclude deer. And it protects what's inside it from deer browse. And this is a prime example. You see this a lot at deer exclosures. On the right of the picture is the excluded area, and on the left is the open area that deer are browsing in. This is also how most of the studies that study the effect of deer eliminate deer as the factor. They put a deer exclosure around the study plot. That's the area that has no deer. The area outside is the area that has deer. And then some other ways you can measure deer impact. These are some of the newer methods that have come out recently. 10 tallest, this is something Tom Rowinski from the US Forest Service has been putting out. It's basically you take put out circular plots and you choose the 10 woody seedlings in the plot and flag them, mark them, and measure their height. You come back and measure their height later, and that sort of gives you an idea of how heavy the browse pressure is in that forest. You can also use sentinel seedlings, as the idea of sentinel seedlings was brought up by Aldo Leopold as early as 1945. These are plants that are sentinels for what's going on in the environment, the canary in the coal mine type of idea. So you choose sacrificial seedlings. You plant out the number of seedlings, and then you look at the percentage of those in your different plots that get browsed. So New Jersey, there's been a lot of work on this in New Jersey. There's data from a lot of different studies of using sentinel seedlings in New Jersey. So you can sort of get an idea of, you know, what different parks are experiencing. And I'll just tell you, most of New Jersey has a very high deer pressure problem. And so that's one example. And I think I put that in the wrong place. Yeah, I did. Okay, so the next one, I saw a poster session out here about this, AVID, Assessing Vegetation Impacts from Deer. There's a nice website with a PDF document that explains a lot of this. They have a smartphone app that you can record your information, and they're especially encouraging people in New York to do this, to build up a collection of data so that we can understand how high the deer pressure is across the state. So this is, you set up 6-foot circular plots, and you either do a spring wildflower survey or tree seedling survey. You mark individuals, and for the wildflowers, you count stems. For the tree seedlings, you measure the heights. And you know, recording that over time gives you an idea of the browse pressure. Royo, I mean, this is the guy that had done the study on legacy effects. He also did a study recently on tree sprouts. Remember, I was showing the tree sprouts that are trying to sprout up but keep getting browse. So he did a study and said that hardwood tree stump sprouts are reliable and easy measure of deer browse. You know, deer browsing generally reduced the sprout height by about 39% when averaged across all the different tree species that he looked at, and that the browsing at a local scale, which is a park scale basically, 1 hectare, tracked to the landscape level deer densities fairly well. So that's another way that you can measure without having to set up plots or whatever. You can look at the deer browse on the resprouts. So now, interaction, we just now heard all the different deer impacts and different ways of measuring deer. What are the interactions with deer and invasives? So invasive species cause many of the same kind of impacts that deer do. And you know, they reduce diversity, they prevent tree seedling regeneration. So how are they related, and which of these stressors on our forest is the dominant stressor? Which one is controlling? Someone talked earlier today about passengers and drivers. Okay, so you know, the controlling stressor would be the driver, and the one that's not controlling would be just a passenger following along, right? Bill McShay in the Washington, D.C. area, he's at the Smithsonian, he did a study, a multi-year study that he published in 2008, is the potential synergy between deer and invasive plants. And he asked the question, do we need to control both deer and invasive plants, or can we control one and then the other one just gets taken care of by itself? Is one factor the overriding factor? So he set up 233 total plots. These were in upland deciduous forest, and so monitoring invasives and deer herbivory. They had 68 deer exclosures that were small, you know, 4 by 4 meter, that's fairly small, where those were the areas with no deer browse. They had 73 invasive removal plots, and then control plots that, you know, had either neither one of these treatments. So, and then some plots received both deer exclusion and invasive removal. And this was a 3-year study. It was published in 2008, but they said they were going to continue it. And, you know, before I forget to tell you, if anybody is going to the Ecological Society of America conference at the end of this month, it's the joint conference with Mid-Atlantic Invasive Plant Council, he's going to be presenting there on this topic. So I hope we're going to hear results of the next 8 years of the study, and we'll see if his conclusions change. So what did he find? He said that the primary inhibitor for most non-woody natives was the presence of invasive plants, not deer. Okay, so remember, he's talking about herbaceous plants being inhibited by the invasives, and the deer were not the primary inhibitor. So his conclusion is that deer management alone, such as the exclosures or reducing the population, without invasive species removal, is not going to help the native plant community towards restoration. Okay, so that's one study. Another study was done, this was in New York, by Dobson and Blossy, and they looked at deer and invasive earthworms. So by the way, if anyone's not aware, all earthworms in New York are not native. The native earthworms were wiped out by the last ice age, and their range goes only up to Maryland. So anywhere you see earthworms, those are not native earthworms. So he looked at the survival of planted seedlings in 15 native understory species with deer and with earthworms. And deer removal and earthworm removal. Well, how do you remove earthworms? Well, in small scale studies, they do it by applying mustard. It causes the earthworms to come out. It's not a control mechanism for earthworms. It's just a way to remove them from a small area, and it has to be repeated. Okay, so what's their conclusion? Their conclusion was that invasive earthworms were the stronger negative effect on seedling survival of many understory plants, including species that were previously thought to benefit from earthworms. Okay, so they're like, okay, this is strange, why? So most of the seedling mortality, they figured out, was due to possibly two reasons, desiccation, possibly due to the litter layer not being there, because the earthworms, you know, chew up the litter layer and it disappears, so there's no litter layer. And the soils are also softer, so there's more aeration in the soil, so possibly erosion from the soils, and also due to frost heave. So remember, these were planted seedlings, so they frost heaved out. And they hypothesized that was possibly due to the soils being excessively loose from the earthworms being, you know, in them. Okay, so again, not proven, but hypothesized reasons why earthworms might have been the stronger effect in this situation. So Davalos did several studies to try to tease out, okay, we have deer, we have earthworms. I didn't mention earlier, we also have slugs, which are a problem with survival of seedlings. Nutrients, okay, so lack of nutrients, and invasive plants. So which of these things are really the real problems? Okay, so they did a bunch of studies with a lot of plots. And they found prevalent but unpredictable interactions between all of them. Okay, so it really means that they're all a problem in different ways, in different situations. However, the negative and direct and indirect of deer overrode all the other effects. Okay, so this is almost a contradiction to McShay's study, which said that invasive plants were the overriding factor rather than deer. These studies were done in New York. McShay's studies were done in Washington, D.C. So you can draw some conclusions possibly from that. So I'm going to tell you some more about some of these studies. So, yeah. Okay. All right. They found the exclusion of deer resulted in reduced earthworm abundance. Okay, so you exclude deer, the earthworm abundance actually declined over time, and that increased the longer the deer were excluded. And they also found that garlic mustard, barberry, and still grass also went down over time as they had excluded deer. So they conclude that reducing deer densities may have multiple benefits beyond protecting the vegetation. Okay, so I thought this was an appropriate ending slide, okay? So I think the message here is there's multiple factors that are impacting our ecosystems, and there's no clear overriding factor in every single environment. But all of these factors do have impacts. And so I think this goes back to the integrated pest management, right? Every factor needs to be looked at if you're going to have success. And I'll leave you with a couple of resources. Okay.